What's the other one going on, the storytelling?
Yeah. So I don't know yet what's going on here, all the work that community organizing projects.
You know, when
whoever's here.
Staying safe at actions.
What to bring and what not to bring.
The two separate files that take one of each.
From Pittsburgh.
Louis from Pittsburgh.
Travis, Montana.
Ashley, Pittsburgh.
Wayne, Indiana. So, for some reason, Patrick asked me to kind of help put this together, this workshop. I'm not sure exactly why, other than the fact that I have worked in medicine for a little while. Not my whole life, but I work in emergency medicine. I don't work in the trauma center, but I do work in emergency medicine as a physician assistant, so. Been doing that for about 15 years, one of my many career changes late in life. Age 50, I became a PA. And I've been in a few demonstrations, although I've never had the experience of doing real lockdowns. Like a few, I think some of the folks here have done real lockdowns. So when we get to that part, maybe some other folks can chip in. And I'm no expert, folks. I don't intend to sit here and lecture to anybody. So if you want to jump in with suggestions or tell me I'm full of shit, please feel free to do so, because you may be right. What I'd like to do, though, is that, remember that one big one I gave you at the beginning, I passed out, the thick one? I'd like to just kind of go through that with you, and I'm going to make some comments on it, if you don't mind. this is kind of a general discussion about planning for demonstrations, staying safe for demonstrations, etc. And it's going to kind of cover a broad range of stuff. I mean, you all know, is there anyone here that's never been to a rally or demonstration? Okay, you've all been in. How many people have been arrested? Okay. I mean, in demonstration, not in your drunk driving charges, Mike. I mean,
we're supposed to bring that up.
He was drunk in protest.
How many people have been in lockdowns? Patrick, all right, so, did you say you? No, okay. So, we're not going to go into detail a lot of that stuff unless you all want to, but I want to stress that most demonstrations that we're in don't require a whole lot of prep. You know, they require a lot of common sense. They don't require a whole lot of preparation. On the other hand, I think we should always assume that anything can be far worse than we expected. And sometimes they're far better than we expected. But most demonstrations don't turn into something where people are going to get hurt or have to run or get tear gassed or pepper spray. Most of the stuff we do. Although, as we know, the world is getting tougher. And the 1% is cracking down more and more. And there is mass resistance starting to build all over this nation. And I think we're going to see more and more of that. So we need to start thinking about that. So let's just go through this. If you look at page 2, it talks about what to wear. Right? And there's some of this is just common sense, like comfortable shoes. I've seen people show up for rallies in some of those ridiculous shoes. They're absurd. You can't run. You can't get away. It's just impossible for anybody to do anything. Your clothing. I've seen people show up for demonstrations where it's going to be 35 or 40 degrees and they have a light jacket on. Get over it. You're going home because you're not going to be able to stick around. You're in danger of hypothermia. You know, you can always take clothes off, but you can't put them on if you don't have them with you. I've seen people show up with some sort of goggles on because they think it protects them from gas, and they have big holes on the side that they haven't plugged because they pulled them off the shelf at Home Depot, and they're there to protect you from flying splinters. That's all they do. All they're going to do is trap the gas in your eyes. They're going to do you a damn bit of good. The whole idea of a Ziploc bandana soaked in vinegar water, that's questionable. Right? There is no, and I'm going to say right from the beginning here, there is no antidote to tear gas, pepper spray, CS gas. There's no antidote to it, except time and distance. You know, if you don't want to get sprayed, get the hell out. If you are determined you don't want to get sprayed, and it looks like they're coming, don't stand there. Just get the hell out. If you're willing to endure some of that, time will take care of it. You know, yes, there's things that are related that you can wash your eyes with, but the truth is, spray's going to hurt, but it's not going to do any major damage to you. Unless you're wearing contacts, all right? And we'll go over that as well. It's always a good idea, and I do this all the time, is I bring a Ziploc bag or two with me. And I always have Ziplocs because I can stick stuff inside of them, and it's probably a good idea if you think you're going to be out a long time to maybe take a change of clothes in some sort of plastic bag. This thing about heavy-duty gloves, yeah, okay, heavy-duty gloves. If you're planning on throwing tear gas, if you're going to go to Egypt and toss back tear gas canisters, you probably need heavy-duty gloves on, right? Well, we're probably not going to see that for a while. We saw a little bit. Did people think shots of us at G20, right?
Yeah.
And people were able to do it. So it would be nice to have them, but the odds are you may not. But in the wintertime, you wear them anyway. A cap or a hat makes all the sense in the world, folks. I mean, think about this. If you're going to be out for a while in the sun, then you want to have something that's going to protect the top of your head, especially if you're bald like me. But in anybody, you want to protect yourself from the sun as much as you can. You go down to what to bring. I gave you a list that's about 25 items long. You could add to that, you could subtract from that, use some common sense with that. But even in here, it talks about lots of water in a plastic bottle. That's a given. You want to keep yourself hydrated, so you always want to have water. If you think you're going to be gassed, there is some evidence that mixing a 1-to-1 Maalox to water mixture in a sport bottle is good for washing out your eyes. That's some pretty solid evidence that seems to break down the gas a little better in your eyes, relieve some of the eye pain. It's not going to stop it. There's no way to stop it. There's only like one or two kinds of goggles that are actually going to stop, unless somebody has some other information I don't have. Do you? It's really going to stop gas from penetrating your eyes.
Well, there's two different things. Well, I mean, let's kind of just let folks know about the different types of gas that there are, because There's really two different main types of gas you'd ever be likely to see. And people call them often the wrong things. So tear gas is generally shot out in in canisters. The canister will go out there, and then the canister will gas. And then there's pepper spray, which you can buy at like the Army Navy store. And that
it's sprayed directly on you.
It's sprayed directly on you. Often when law enforcement use pepper spray in large protests, it looks is in a container that looks a lot more like a fire extinguisher sometimes, or like a can of WD-40. So there is something, if there's a way you can avoid to have a direct blast of that coming at you, then that's a good thing. Like, yeah, it's gonna get in the sides, but like getting a little bit on you is better than getting a lot on you. Yeah. But it sucks. Has anybody ever been pepper sprayed before? Yeah. It sucks. We had some friends who wanted to know what it would be like before like a certain protest, because they thought they were going to be pepper sprayed. So they pepper sprayed each other. One pepper sprayed the other one, and then did.
Jeez.
This was Ryan Lynch. If you're in a place where you're not moving at all, you're not going to move, like you've locked yourself or something, they're trying to convince you want to move. Have been some experiences where law enforcement will use pepper spray on, either as a gel in a gel form, or spray it directly into a Q-tip and apply it to your eyes there. That's relatively rare and mostly illegal, but it has happened. Usually we don't see pepper spray except for when there's a direct kind of person-to-person confrontation with a law enforcement officer, and we don't see. So pepper spray is a person-to-person crowd control device, and tear gas is a large crowd dispersion device. So,
and you probably all saw the video of Cal Davis where the person was spraying pepper spray directly on people sitting down. Right?
Yeah. So, I've been tear gassed, I've been pepper sprayed, I've been pepper sprayed without any protection, I've been pepper sprayed with protection, I've been tear gassed without protection.
Sucks either way.
It sucks either way. Really, that's all there is to it. It sucks. If you can avoid getting it like directly to hit your face, then you can't be able to laugh. Right.
But the bottom line, again, is all that if there's no serious antidote for it, it takes longer with pepper spray than just tear gas. Tear gas, you can get away a lot quicker. Pepper spray is on you. Right. So the tear gas may get into some of your clothing, but it dissipates. It's not like pepper spray, which hangs on you for a while. You're going to feel like you're on fire. You're not. You're not on fire, but it's going to hurt like hell. Back into this list, some of the other things that I suggest taking is, it's up to you whether or not you want to take ID. Some people don't want to take ID, because some people do not want to identify themselves, but that means you should plan on some time in jail. Because without ID, they're going to hold you for a while, and they're going to see you as pretty uncooperative, but that's an individual choice you make. I always take ID. That doesn't mean I'm trying to get out of jail right away, but I always take ID, and I always have it in a Ziploc bag. Because sometimes law enforcement will just use hoses on people. Well, if you happen to have all your ID in a wallet or in a purse or in your pocket, and you get sprayed, the only thing that's going to survive probably is your driver's license, because it's plasticized. Everything else is going to turn to shit. It's going to turn into cardboard mush. So put it in a Ziploc bag. You know, what does it take to do that? You know, that way you always got it. But again, it's up to you. And just like it says, you're just enough money to pay for a payphone, food, and transportation. Some people don't like to show up with any money at all. Some people prefer to show up money. Recently, 12 of us got arrested about 3 months ago for blocking an intersection in Pittsburgh over transit. Some of us deliberately went down with $100 in our pocket. We expected that's probably what it would be to get out. We were still held for 24 hours, but some of us got out 4 or 5 hours faster than those that had to wait for somebody to bring down $100. Because the odds of you being able to get to an ATM are pretty slim. And you probably want to have your card, and they're not going to take a check in most cases. They're looking for cash only. But again, this is an individual decision. I always have some paper and a pen with me. Always. You need to do that for yourself, even though it may be taken off of you. But you also need to do it, if you're not being one of the ones being arrested, to write down who the other people are. We had a demonstration quite a few months ago in Pittsburgh. where, I mean, you have to look at me. I'm 67 years old. I'm an old white guy. I get away with some shit that some people would not get away with. I just walked up to this lieutenant who had just arrested four people, and I got in his face and said, I want their names. He looked at me like, the fuck are you? And I said, I just want their names. And he took me over to the back of the van and said, hey, everybody, give me your name. And it worked. So we got people out of jail, you know? Not everybody's going to be able to get away with it. I acknowledge that. But a lot of times people will shout out their name. You may not remember it. You know, you may have to be able to write it down if you're not one of the ones being arrested. It's always a good idea to do that. Water or alcohol-based sunscreen. Never bring oil-based anything. It's going to trap the gas. Don't have oil-based. Don't have makeup on that's oil-based. If you wear makeup, it's all that's a bad idea. Anything that's oil-based is bad in demonstrations or rallies. All of it is. Don't have it. Sunscreen is a pretty damn good idea. You know, if you're going to be out there for a while, use that. I can't stress enough, the last thing you see in there is your inhaler, EpiPen, insulin, or other meds. Many people have been caught without that stuff. If you get tear gassed, you're going to need that inhaler. You're going to need it pretty fast, as a matter of fact, because that's what it does. It'll kind of choke you up, it'll make your eyes water. If you're a diabetic, you don't need your insulin. You got to prove to them in the jail you're a diabetic by going into a diabetic coma, because then they got to do shit for you. Until you go into a diabetic coma. And even then, they may not notice you. An EpiPen. You ever bring those with an EpiPen? People have anaphylactic, allergic reactions. Take it with you. Take your medications if you're on constant medications. But don't put it in a Ziploc bag by itself. Because they'll think it's drugs. It has to be in the original container. The original container with your doctor's name on it and your name on it. It can't be in a real container with somebody else's name on it, because then you're really in trouble. Right? Got to be in the original container, and it should be the latest one with the current date on it.
In a way to deal with that, if you don't want to take your entire prescription with you, right, is you leave, you take some out, and you,
right,
you just, you use your, you know, your most recent container. You can have it in a plastic baggie in your bathroom. That's not a problem.
That's right.
Probably not in your pocket in action. Pills in a plastic bag in your pocket, and an action is probably not a good idea.
Right. So other things I'm going to suggest you bring, and I usually do bring, is, again, I'm going to use a Ziploc bag. It's not in here, but it's on your larger list. What do you think you might use a clothespin for in a demonstration? Anybody have any idea? A nosebleed. If somebody starts getting a nosebleed, or if they get hit or whatever, the nosebleed, you take a clothespin, you clamp it right there, you're going to stop the nosebleed. Some of it, you know, down the back of the throat. It's no different from the device we use in the emergency department. I clamp people's noses all the time with a fancy clothespin. It's a medical device, so they charge $50 for it. It's a piece of plastic that's spring-loaded. And you clamp right there, and it stops an awful lot of the bleeding. Right? Doesn't hurt to bring one with you. Does anybody know, what is this? Anybody know? Anybody work in medicine?
Tourniquet.
Right, that's a tourniquet. What's this?
A tourniquet.
It's a tube tire that you can cut tourniquets out of. There you go. Now, will you ever need a tourniquet? I bet people feel free to cut that up if they want, right? It's just an old tube, right? Makes a great tourniquet. It's no different from the medically approved one right there on the floor, but again, they probably charge $10 a piece for it. Got a little tube tire. Will you ever need a tourniquet? Not likely. You probably won't. But if you go into something that's really serious, looks like there's going to be some real police action, some heavy action, or if there's some gangs or thugs or right-wingers that are going to attack you, the odds are you're only going to have abrasions, you're going to have some bruises, you're probably not going to have some bleeder that can't be stopped with just simple compression. But every once in a while it happens to people, right? And it might happen on a finger, it might happen anywhere. If it happens in the head, remember, you don't tourniquet the neck, folks. You don't do any good to tourniquet the neck. You will stop the bleeding. Just don't do that. You will stop the bleeding.
You'll stop the bruises.
You'll stop all bleeding. Stop bleeding into the heart and everywhere, right? So tourniquets are very, very useful. You just tie it off real quick. It doesn't require any particular skill. Just tie it off. I can give you a quick anecdotal example, not for a demonstration. I was moving back from Baltimore to Pittsburgh. My two kids in the truck. I got a big truck all loaded with furniture. My wife partner had gone ahead in another truck. I got the 4 to 5 year old in the truck with me, and I slashed up with the back of my finger, and it's spurting. I mean, it's literally spurting. I'm 2 miles from the emergency department where I just resigned. But I didn't have time to go there with a 4 to 5 year old. We put a tourniquet around my finger and left it on for about 10 minutes. My finger turned white. But it stopped the bleeding, so enough that we get a compressive bandage on it. And those things will happen, and that's where attorney comes in handy. Take some 1-inch bandages in your wallet. What are you laughing at?
I'll do blood.
You don't do blood? Well, thank you for being out there when I need attorney get on me. And a couple of 1-inch band-aids, a couple of 3-inch band-aids, throw them in there. Throw in your pack. It's always a good thing to have. A simple thing called an ace bandage. Simple thing called an ace bandage may bundle up somebody's wrist or ankle or whatever so they can run a little bit better. It also works as compression, right? Works very well if someone's got something you need to compress, even though it doesn't need to be sewed up, it's not spurting, they need some compression on it. It's a good thing to have that. Some people say bring a couple of gauze pads with you. That's always a good idea. You're not going to worry a whole lot about cleanliness. You want to stop from bleeding so people can get the hell out of there. The goal is not for you to get some antiseptic and clean it all out. You're not a street medic. You know, you're just trying to help each other. What not to do. Never wear contacts. I don't think you should wear contacts to any demonstration because you never know when they might decide to spray you with gas. And when that gas gets under your contacts, you are really going to be hurt. If you do have contacts in and you get gas, get them out, throw them away, don't ever plan on using them again. They're done. All right? Just don't wear contacts. Don't wear any dangly shit. Who's got earrings on? Anybody? Anybody got earrings on? They kind of dangle a little bit. I see people show up at demonstrations with things hanging down this far. Jesus, what if somebody yanks on that sucker? This is really going to hurt. How about somebody hanging out of your nose? How'd you like some cop to just whack you and pull on that thing? Don't wear dangly shit. This doesn't make any sense. You know, you could be immobilized with those things. Just doesn't make sense to do that. And most of all, we all like coffee. I know we all like coffee. People like Mountain Dew. Don't drink caffeine before you go into a demonstration because you have to pee. That's what caffeine does. Caffeine is a diuretic. It helps to strip fluid from your body. Right? Don't drink a lot of caffeine because you'll be looking for a bathroom and you'll be peeing in the streets. Which brings me to my next topic. Anybody have any idea what these are? This is a depends. Anybody know what a depends is?
It's an adult diaper.
It's an adult diaper, that's right. This is an adult-sized diaper. You going into a lockdown? Wear one. You haven't seen them? I'll pass them around. You don't want to handle them, that's fine. Wear one. Now, you're probably sitting there thinking, oh, that is so fucking embarrassing if I would put a depends on. You think that's embarrassing? Be in a lockdown and piss your pants. Have to go. Then cops aren't going to say, yes, I'll let you go to the bathroom. You're in a lockdown with a bunch of other people. Put a depends on. I know that sounds horrible, but they can be very helpful. I suggest wearing them. They're not just for old men like me.
I got a question about the pens.
Yeah.
How many pissings are they good for?
I don't know. I don't know. I can't tell you that. What's that?
Wear two pairs.
Wear two pairs, right?
Yeah, you're right.
You know, you never know how long you're going to be deaf somewhere. All right, page 7, I'm going to keep running through this. Page 7, and I think I've pretty much covered those topics. Is there anything that anybody want to add to anything of what I just said? Patrick, you want anything? I want to get into medical conditions briefly, and I want to add a couple things. In a demonstration, for whatever reason, you may suddenly develop a rash. Maybe it's an allergic reaction to tear gas, maybe it's an allergic reaction to a bush. Don't worry about the most rashes, folks. They go away. This is exactly what we tell most patients in the emergency department. Don't worry about it. You want to go home and take some Benadryl? The truth is, almost all rashes just resolve completely on their own. It's an incidental event. If you want to take some Benadryl, but then like you drown, that's fine. It's going to itch like hell, but it's just a rash. It talks about diabetes in here. Is anybody here diabetic? People that have no diabetes? Yeah. You ever seen anybody that needed something? What'd you give them?
An orange.
You have an orange? Yeah. You just give them something sweet, a piece of candy. It solves the problem for most people. You don't need to panic. You don't need to go get a medic. They will generally know what the hell's going on. They'll tell you that. Get me a candy bar. Get me something. Just get the sugar level back up. That's all you got to do. This is not a medical emergency unless they become unconscious. And then it's beyond you, and you need to get somebody. Anaphylactic shock. Does anybody know what, everybody here know what that is?
Mm-hmm.
Your throat starts to close up. Most people don't have to go into anaphylactic shock from bee stings. We run into bees in demonstrations, you know? It can happen from other things too, but it's mostly from bees, hornets, wasps. most people do not go into anaphylactic shock. If you didn't go into one almost immediately, you're not going to go into one. So don't worry about it. Don't think that you need to rush off somewhere to an emergency department or call a medic because you got stung by a bee. Your arm may swell up. I have seen people swell from here to here in 2 hours, red, warm, and huge from a single bee sting. It goes away. It's not an infection. It's not life-threatening. It's not going to do a damn thing to you. It'll just go away.
It just
looks like hell. It's scary.
Yeah.
But you're talking about it, and you're breathing okay, so you're fine. It's a localized allergic reaction.
Question about bee stings. Do bee stings, do you develop, like, conditions, like, allergy to bee sting over time, or, like, you get stung once and it doesn't do much, and then you get stung and it, like, swells, and then it gets swells more, and then so you just go in shock? Is that a thing, or is it just, like, sometimes
it's like,
you react badly?
It's like almost all allergies to even food. It may be the first time you do it, it may be the 100th time you do it. Now, once you've had that reaction, you should always have an EpiPen with you. Always. But if you've never had that reaction, the odds of it is going to happen are pretty slim. Right? But there's no, it's not like the first time or the fifth time or the 12th time or anything else, any more than it is to food allergies that you discover they have. Sometimes you've been eating something for a long, long time, and then you're 37 years old, and you just ate peanuts for your 27th year, and suddenly you're allergic to it. There's no rhyme or reason to it. Right? It just happens. I think I went over inhalers before. If you see somebody wheezing, short of breath, chest tightness, they can generally tell you if they're an asthmatic, if they're exposed to gas, or even if they're just having some sort of asthmatic attack right then and there. Get an inhaler. It doesn't have to be their inhaler. It needs to be an inhaler. Start screaming for one. Ask other people for one. And they know what to do with it. Just get them one. Right? The odds are if they sit down and rest, they'll probably be okay for a while. But if they seem to be getting worse and worse, you've got to get them an inhaler. If you can't get them an inhaler, then yeah, you've got to get them some help. And they'll know that too. I mean, any asthmatic knows when they're getting in serious trouble and need some serious medical help. It mentions heart attacks here. There's only one thing you need to do a heart attack, and that's get a medic. Although if you can do BLS, also known as CPR, go ahead and do it. Doing some BLS, some CPR, some chest compressions is better than doing nothing. You don't have to be trained in it. It's nice if you've trained it, it's nice if you're certified, so you know exactly what to do, but doing it poorly is better than not doing it at all. The trick is to get that blood pumping into the brain. Right? And if you're just pounding on their chest, try to do it like 100 times a minute, just fast, boom, 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 right over their heart, you're helping them. Right? They may be gone. I've done it twice on people. They were both gone when I found them, they were both gone when I was done, when the medics were done too, just people I found on the street. But you gotta try. The next page is about seizures. There is little to be done for seizures except to lie the person down, help them out as best you can. If you've got a belt or something you put in their mouth, and they appear to be chewing their tongue, maybe turn their head to the side. They don't need a medic. In almost every case, unless it's brand new, most people know what the seizures are. Now, I had to fight off the medics once at a farmer's market because a guy fell down and was having a seizure. A friend said he had seizures. Everybody at the farmer's market is calling 911 and everything else. We had to fight them off. He finally came to. He was there enough. He had grand mal seizures, the major ones. He was enough so he could refuse treatment. So I refused to go, I'm not going. And I kept saying to him, he doesn't need to go. It turns out I knew one of the ambulance attendants, but that's beside the point. Most people with seizures do not need to go to the emergency department. If you take them to an emergency department, they're simply going to say, oh, they had a seizure. They have a history of seizure? Good. Go see your neurologist. You're discharged. That's it. There's nothing to be done. It's different, of course, if they have an injury that needs to be treated, if they've suffered a serious head injury or something like that. Otherwise, which takes us right into head injuries. People have this weird... Should I stop for a minute? Everybody cool? Mm-hmm. We're doing
we're
good.
Mm-hmm.
People have this weird notion that if you hit your head and you feel a little funny afterwards, that you need to go to the emergency department and get a CAT scan or a CT scan to see if you have a brain bleed. Well, no, you don't. You should feel funny after you hit your head. If I walk over here and fall down and whack my head against something, I'm going to feel a little funny. It's going to hurt like hell. I may feel a little dizzy for a little bit. But unless I'm really disoriented, vomiting, can't maintain my balance, you don't need help. My vision changes. There's a number of things you can check on people. You want to ask them about things. It's these things called time, place, person, and purpose. What time is it? Which includes a day. Who are you? What's the purpose you're here for? Where are you? If they can answer all those questions, they're doing pretty good. They don't need to be rushed up to an emergency department. They may have a bruise sticking out that far from their head, you know, and it's huge, and it's, and it looks really ugly, but that doesn't mean they need a cat scan. It's just they need to watch them, that's all. If they suddenly develop worsening symptoms, then yes, you need to get a medic, you need to get an ambulance, you need to get to an emergency.
How about pupils different size?
Pupils different size is a concern, yes. And you want to ask them if that's a problem they've had in the past. Mm. Because there are people who have pupils of different size. But some people tell you, yeah, this one doesn't work right.
Hmm.
So you always want to ask them. The other thing you want to ask people about and it leads into is, did they take any drugs? You know, people may be acting disoriented. What do they have before the demonstration? Did they drink that more? Did they have a half a bottle of vodka? You know, they be able to smell that. Did they have anything else? You know, that could account for some of the disoriented feeling that they're having. So ask those kinds of questions. Any other questions about head injuries?
I've heard people say that there's like a certain amount of times that you can get a concussion before you really start to do damage.
This is a good time to stop and explain something about head injuries. Does anybody know what a concussion is?
It's a bruise on the brain.
It's a bruise on the brain. Right. Is it a bleed on the brain? Not really, no. Does a concussion show on any known scan that we do? No, it doesn't show. So we don't advise getting CAT scans. If people come in with their kids all the time, or with their adults, and I'll make an exception about not getting CAT scans. If you're over 60, we give you a CAT scan, frankly. My age, I automatically get a CAT scan, I hit my head real hard. And the least bit of having any problems, I'll get one, because after 60 or around 60, the brain begins atrophying. It gets a little smaller inside of this thing called the skull, and it bounces around a little more. Plus, the capillary beds, the small vessels in our body, become more friable, more fragile, and so they bleed a little bit more. So one of the things we do for old people, and I'm one of them, is that we do an automatic CAT scan. On anybody other than that, a concussion is not shown anything. A concussion, and here's a classic example of concussion. When I was working at Shady Side, there was a 17-year-old kid who had been in a head-to-head collision in a soccer game. Parents brought him in because he couldn't remember anything. He had total amnesia of the event. And he seemed a little weird. Now that he had total amnesia of the event, I had to introduce myself every time I walked in the room because he couldn't create new memories. That's a concussion. He had no brain. You know, he hadn't even been knocked out, but he couldn't remember. Well, we don't know if he was knocked out. They weren't sure. But he couldn't remember the event at all. There's nothing to be done for concussion that time does not heal. Some people miss an entire semester of school. Some people miss months of work with a concussion. Some people have a concussion to go back to playing football. You know, you really shouldn't. but, you know, some people go back to it right away. A concussion is not something you can diagnose right then and there in almost every case. It's usually something that shows up 24 to 48 hours later, the effects of it. A brain bleed is what we're talking about when people are really disoriented, vomiting, vision changes, those sorts of things. That's a brain bleed. And that's something that's very serious. That generally doesn't happen. You're dropping off a third story building, you'll have one. You probably also have a fractured skull.
What about being batoned on the head or something like that? You could get a brain bleed from that, couldn't you?
If you get batoned on the head and you're screaming and yelling about how much the cops just did you and you're walking away, you don't have a brain bleed.
I'm not screaming.
Yeah. Well, if you're knocked down and you're out, mm-hmm. Yeah, if you're knocked down and you're out and you're unconscious, you need to get some medical care. Yeah. We try and wake you up. We can't wake you up, it's even worse. But if we wake you up and we can't get you back to your normal state, then you probably need a CAT scan. Yeah. But if we can get you back to your pretty much normal state, you're doing okay. There's a number of tests we do with people that are just normal tests, like finger, nose touch. I'm not going to go through all those. I don't want you to go out and try and do that with everybody and think you know what you're doing. Not that it's any great skill, but there's certain things you should do. But a lot of it is just questioning people and talking to people, asking to relate the events that just happened. If they have no amnesia to the event, the odds are they're going to be okay. You're going to have headaches. But if you start vomiting and you're losing your balance and speech is slurred or you're having some vision problems, things like that, then that's certainly a concern. Certainly a concern. The thing here about psychiatric conditions. I'm not sure why it's covered in here, but it's probably a good thing to do. because it just talks about something we were talking about before. If somebody seems to be disoriented, one of the things you need to ask them about is if they do have a psychiatric condition. You need to be honest about that, right up front with them about it. There are some people who are just disoriented in life. There are some people who go through psychotic episodes. There's not much you can do about that. So it may not be the result of something that happened in a rally or a demonstration. However, it may be the result of some trauma that they saw during the demonstration. This could be a trigger event for somebody. You know, if somebody's seen somebody killed in something or hurt somebody, or even they've been a veteran of a war, they've been a rape victim, an assault victim, seeing police do things to people could trigger an event on those people. There's not much you can do except comfort them, you know, put your arms around them, maybe get them out of that. You still need to get them out of that situation. Get them out, hug them, be with them, and just offer the person all the personal help you can. There's not much else to be done with psychiatric conditions. And most people will tell you if they have such a condition. You know, they'll know that. They may even have some medications they need to take right then and there, but that's usually not the case. And also in those cases, you want to ask those people about a drug history, alcohol, anything like that they may have done. Page 12 starts going into the heat problems. And this is going to be a real problem in demonstrations. Both heat and cold. We'll just do heat first. Heat exhaustion, if you look at page 12, it pretty much describes it. Fatigue, cool, clammy skin, weakness, dizziness, etc., etc. It was just heat exhaustion, and that started to happen. Michael, do you remember? Do you remember down in D.C. when we were out in that field?
Oh, yeah.
Before the rally? Wanda was starting to go into heat exhaustion. Wanda Guthrie, who's here. Wanda, we've been standing out in this field for about 2 hours. You know, you go to rallies, and everybody who ever thought about helping out with a rally gets to speak, right? It's 90 degrees, we're standing out in an open field and letting every single person speak. And Wanda just started feeling really faint, and she was going into heat exhaustion. What do you do for heat exhaustion? Get him in the shade. Get him in the shade, give him some water, have him sit down and rest. That's all. They're going to be fine. Heat stroke's another story entirely. Heat stroke is a medical emergency and not something you're prepared to deal with. You want to get them cool as quick as you can, but they need to get some help. They're going to need some fluids. They need to go to the emergency department.
And the easiest way to tell somebody that heat stroke is they've stopped sweating, right?
Stop sweating, exactly right. It says they will be not sweating. This is the way to tell the two apart. They are exhausted as opposed to just tired. The skin is really hot. It's flushed and it's dry. And they're bright red. They don't look good at all. And they may be confused and disoriented as well. These people need some serious help. It's beyond your control or even my control. Hypothermia is something you need to talk about. What is hypothermia?
Cooling, the internal.
Right. What happens to people with hypothermia?
You die, you humble.
You can die, that's exactly right. You what?
You humble. Mumble, bumble, stumble, mumble.
Mumble, right. If you're in a lockdown and it's cold weather, even if it's 50 degrees, that's colder than you. You can get into a hypothermic state when it's 60 degrees. It's colder than you. People think if they go in the water at 60, 65 degrees, they're not going to be hypothermic. Of course they will. Your temperature's 98. Water's 60. It's going to try to continually lower your temperature. Hypothermia is a very serious condition.
What is the most likely condition for hypothermia to occur in?
Long, prolonged exposure to cold.
And rain.
And rain, yes. Your clothes are wet. Right. Now, if your clothes aren't wet, that's not the case. If you're wearing rain gear, it's not the case. Right? But if you're in wet clothing, absolutely. Because you might as well just be in water. You might as well be swimming in a lake. Exactly.
You're more likely to get hypothermia between 30 and 50 degrees when it's raining than when it's below freezing and snow.
Absolutely. Yep. Good point.
That's when it's dangerous, because people didn't wear rain gear, and they're wearing cotton, and they get wet, and now they're in trouble.
Which just keeps up. That stuff does not dry out. Yeah. The other thing about, by the way, about wearing rain gear or nylon jackets even, is it will keep gas off your skin. It's pretty good at doing that. So it's always, might be a good idea to just have that in your pack, whatever you're carrying. A Viking jacket. A Viking jacket's terrific. It's very lightweight. It'll keep a lot of water off you, etc.
And I just want to kind of emphasize that, like, of all the things we've talked about today, like, the three most common action-related injuries have nothing to do with tear gas, pepper spray,
right.
Police batons, tasers. It's heat exhaustion, frostbite, or, you know, borderline hypothermia, and dehydration. Those are three things, because what's going on in an action, you are usually somewhere outside, somewhere where, whether it's a permanent action or not, you know, it's you're generally in somebody else's space, so we don't have the time to get into, you know, get into a shelter, and we don't always have the type of gear, you know, that we would want to have. The types of things that, you know, we deal with in actions and we see people kind of go down with in actions are, you know, not usually police related. It's things that happen when you're outside in any type of temperature, whether it's hot, cold, or moderate, for a long period of time. And it's because there's so many other emotions going on, some of the things we're paying attention to when there's a lockdown, when there's a blockade, when there's facing off the police, there's this, that, the other thing, there's a lot of emotions. People don't pay attention to what's going on with their bodies. So the number one thing we can do is pay attention to what's going on with our bodies and also pay attention to what's going on with our friends' bodies.
Which means it's a really good idea to have one person designated as kind of someone who's going to be a health overseer or something, whatever, who's going to walk around and talk to people. And I'll give you an example again. I think it was it 2003 that people blocked an anti-war demonstration, people blocked the corner of 5th and Craig. Do you remember what you said?
I was there.
2003. One of the early anti-war demonstrations, and we had a rather large anti-war march, and a bunch of people decided to block the street. It was November, December, I forget what it was, maybe January, but no, it was winter. It was winter. The people laid down in the street, they're going to block it. And they laid there for a while. They crouched under the fitter, because people were getting cold, were freezing their asses off. And then they laid there for a little while longer. Finally, I said, the cops, what are you doing? He said, nothing. He said, we're not going to arrest them. They can say they're all goddamn dead. We'll let them lay there. We don't care. We don't need this intersection. Because they knew damn well that sooner or later these people were going to suffer hypothermia. And they would have to get their ass up. So finally, a couple of just went around and said, okay, here's the situation we're in, folks. This is when you start talking about using common sense and good judgment. Molly rushed and a bunch of us were laying there. And we started walking around saying, here's what the cops are planning to do. They're not going to do a damn thing. You're not going to get arrested. Or if you do get arrested, it'll be after everybody else has left. Because everybody is leaving. They're cold. They got their kids with them. They're just done. And the crowd is thinning out. And you're laying here on cold pavement. And the cops have said, we have no intention of arresting them. We're going to let them freeze their asses off. Well, that ended it. That's called using common sense, frankly. You know, at that point, they realized they weren't going to gain anything from doing this. The media would have been gone when they got arrested. No, it wouldn't have gained a damn thing. Right? So they just got left at that point. But hypothermia, you're right, it's a very, very serious condition. You can, what does that say about how you dress for rallies? It means you have layers on. You can take stuff off. You can't put stuff on that you don't have with you.
And cotton, not cotton.
Not cotton.
Cotton kills.
Right? No fleece on the outside. Fleece on the outside, one absorbs, some of it absorbs, but it also traps tear gas, gas. Anything that's on the outside that is fleecy or even woolly stuff, even though it's as good as wool is, also traps gas. So if you have something to put over the top of that, it's really good, which also blocks wind. Because wind is going to take the heat off your body. If you're standing in a wind, it's just stripping you of heat. Every second you're standing in that wind, the heat's going off your body. Just don't macho it out. Don't be crazy. Doesn't make any sense. Anything more about hypothermia?
Disorientation, stumbling, cold, they'll like shivering. That's like gonna happen. They're gonna be also like there's a tendency for people who have hypothermia, like it's not like real disorientation where they're like, I don't know where I am, but it's like, I'm fine, let's keep going. And that's like one of the hardest things about hypothermia is that like people are gonna be telling you they're fine, but they're gonna be stumbling, you know, they're gonna have the umbles, and
what do you do for them?
Get them something. If you can, get to shelter, blankets, hot liquids, soups, coffee, hot chocolate, something that just goes right into the core. And then like, and they're probably going to have to be inside for several hours. Like, it's not like, oh, I'm going to go inside for 15 minutes. When someone has hypo, like, they're out.
If they have wet clothing on, fuck modesty. Get that wet clothing off of them. It's for their own good. Because you're not going to warm them when they've still got their wet clothing on. Ain't gonna happen. You gotta get it off, gotta get something else on me. There's 15 wrapping them in some blankets you found. You just gotta do that. And don't let anybody tell you that they want to macho it out even though their hands are now aching from the cold. Frostbite is horrible. And frostbite will be with you forever. All of my fingers were frostbitten when I was hauling steel once, and I spent 8 hours in the Gary Mill unloading at 8 different spots in that one damn mill, chaining and unchaining and tarping and untarping a load of iron, and it was like zero and there was a wind blowing. And to this day, if I hit 40 degrees, my hands just start turning numb. They start turning numb, they get a little pale, and they hurt. Frostbite is no fun. And you're not good to anybody else either if you get frostbite. So don't macho it out, you know, and think you could stick it out. Get some help. Anything else on heat or cold? I think we pretty much covered gas, except I want to add a couple things. That's, if you go to 14, that's a nice thing. I want to, want you to look on page 15. It says, women who are could be pregnant or trying to get pregnant could be at risk of spontaneous abortion or increased risk of birth defects. You know, that's not saying that if you're sprayed, you're going to have a spontaneous abortion. It doesn't mean you're going to have a birth defect. But this is a risk. You should know that. You should know that when you go into a demonstration, that this is something risky you're being exposed to. We've been over contact lenses. Don't wear the contact lenses. Nursing mothers, if you have some toxins in you, if you're still nursing, you may be passing that on. That's a temporary thing, but just be aware of that. Respiratory diseases, we've talked about that already. If you're an asthmatic and they're spraying gas, you might want to just get the hell out of there. You know, don't say, oh, I've got my inhaler, because it ain't going to work. It's just not enough. You just need to get the hell out if you're a serious asthmatic. It talks on page 16 and 17 about how to deal with gas, infection from gases again, oils don't do any good. It's still time and distance from most gases that we went over before. Stay calm. Don't rub your eyes, whatever you do. Just don't rub them. Try and get rid of the clothing that has gas in them. And I can't stress the contact lenses enough that you should not wear them. If you have them, get rid of them. Just throw them away. Right? Remember that every time you rub any mucous membrane, you're just rubbing that stuff in. You don't want to do that. It mentions, you want to say something?
Yeah, don't touch your face or your genitals either.
That's right.
Don't scratch. Do not scratch. Don't do it. If you have pepper spray on your hands, just don't do it.
I compare spray almost to like poison ivy oil. You know, you only get a rash from poison ivy where you've been exposed to the oil. Once you get rid of the oil, you may still have an allergic reaction for a while, but it's not going to get a whole lot worse. And the same is true with this. Once you've been exposed, you're going to burn like hell, but if you get away from it, it's not going to get worse. And eventually it will just dissipate, but it just hurts like hell every time. You look down the bottom of 16, we have this thing about recommending treating small areas at a time with mineral oil followed immediately by alcohol. Forget it. Don't try it. It's really small areas. It has to be done by somebody who knows what they're doing. It's not worth it. You've got pepper spray all over your body. You're not going to do that to your whole body. Tough it out. It's going to go away. It's like getting a first-degree burn. You know, if you have a bad sunburn or burn yourself in a pot, it hurts for a while, but then eventually it goes away. It goes over gas masks here, and once again, if you want to read that whole thing, there are gas masks made you can certainly wear. It will completely protect you. It also makes you a target. I mean, if I'm a cop and I see somebody out there with this full respirator, you better believe when I'm trying to figure out a way to yank that off that face and spray behind that mask. Sure in hell. So you just need to think about that. There aren't too many ways you can protect yourself with a mask.
I would just say encourage people to not think that taking a shower is at all a good idea when especially when sprayed by pepper spray, and it just kind of spreads and makes it much worse.
What does hot water do? What does hot water do to anything?
Opens
what does
the
heat
pores.
Do? Opens the pores. It opens the pores up. Cold showers, there's some evidence that cold showers does help. But hot showers, do not get into any hot water, like anything else, you know? If you have a bruise and you put heat on it, the bruise is going to get bigger because it opens up your blood vessels and allows more bleeding. If you put cold on it, which is why you see that happening after accidents and the games, you're actually going to shut it down. Same thing with your pores. Put hot water on, you open them up, it's going to be much worse. Plus, you're getting hot water on top of something that's already hot. It doesn't make any sense at all. But there's some evidence. I don't know if I'd get in the shower at all, but
yeah.
Some people think it's a good idea. This takes us to a thing called aftercare, which I'm not going to go into immediately. I'm not going into detail. Once again, any place that poison ivy oil has touched your clothing, that clothing now carries the oil. Any place the pepper spray has touched your clothing, you've got it in there. You don't plan on taking that into the house. Don't plan on taking that around your kids. Don't plan on asking somebody else to hold it or wiping your face with it or anything else. Get rid of it. You know, put it in a plastic bag. It's going to go away after a while. The effects go away after a while. But in the meantime, you need to get it off you because it's holding spray on you. Drinking some water. Yeah, it's always a good idea to drink water. It's good to drink water in general, right, to help detox your body. But don't go out and drink a bunch of booze. You're taxing your liver. This is not a good way to celebrate after you've just been exposed to a lot of gas. Oh, Patrick just ruined your after Bradley celebrations, didn't it?
Yes.
It's just not a good idea. And the other thing is, I want to stress to you again about caffeine. If you take a shitload of caffeine in before or during a demonstration, you're going to have to pee. That's all there is to it. And you may have to move your bowels more often as well. And this is something you don't want to do. I never, ever drink a cup of coffee before a rally. That morning, I just don't drink coffee at all. I love coffee. I just don't. It makes it worse for me.
But also, don't do that thing where you're like, oh, well, I'm not going to drink water because I don't want to have to go to the bathroom.
That's
right. A lot of people do that at marches. And like that's how we end up with that like situation with dehydration, heat exhaustion, hypothermia. It's because people aren't drinking enough water. The best thing to do is like have one of the things you pay attention to in planning your action be trying to figure out a way to use a restroom, be comfortable.
If you're sitting in your living room and you're not doing anything, and you drink a hell of a lot of water, you're going to pee a whole lot more. If you're out in the sun, and you're walking around, and you're exercising, you're losing water all the time. Breathing, you're losing water. You know the old trick they do in elementary school, they hold a Kleenex in front of your face, right? And you breathe. It gets wet, because you're expelling water. Every time you sneeze, your eyes run a little bit, you sweat, you lose an incredible amount of water with just going around during the day, so you got to replace that, especially if you're out in the sun, and it's a hot day. But don't worry about having to pee just because you took a lot of water. My last comment is simply about common sense and knowing when to bail, when to get the hell out. I mean, that's an individual judgment, but it should be, if you're in a affinity group, a collective judgment as well, that you look around the situation and realize we may not be gaining from the situation, so let's get the hell out of here. Yes, on principle, we'd like to stay. Yes, on principle, we'd like to stand our ground and fight or rally or protest or sit down, but there are times when we have to say, we're not gaining the thing, we're not helping the movement. And it's not going to help anybody if somebody beats the hell out of me and I'm isolated. I need to get the hell out of here. So get on your feet and run like hell. Common sense, good judgment. Try to get somebody with you, in many cases, who's kind of police liaison. Sometimes they can be pretty good at holding cops off. You'd be surprised at what a good police liaison can do in some situations.
Nice guy right there.
Yeah, I do that a lot. It's the advantage of being a 67-year-old white guy. I don't have anything else to add, but I'm perfectly happy to answer any questions, or if we just want to start roundtabling experiences, sharing experiences about it. You have some good things you've been having, you? Anything else?
You sort of hit on it, but I don't know if you said it directly. You talked about affinity groups and keeping your eyes open, but it's important that other people keep eyes open too, like buddies, making sure constantly people are okay. Because
right.
Hypothermia, you may get to the point where you're not thinking right anymore.
Or you won't be.
Yeah.
You won't be. Like he said, you'll be saying, I'm fine, I can go on. Yeah, you're not making good decisions. And somebody else has to be able to say, no, you're not, and you're going to stop. Yeah, no, you can't continue in this march even, because you look like hell. And we're going to get you into that restaurant over there, wherever we can get you to. That's what we're going to do with you, whether you like it or not. That's what has to happen.
Yeah. When we run streets, we always, even like within the affinity group, we always have buddies. So like even if the affinity group disintegrates, and even like so that we even have that substructure to our larger decision making structure of like, you're with this person and you're watching them and they're watching you. And if we were really good at it, we would never get farther than as far as he is from me. Like we would never be farther than that far apart.
And don't count on your cell phone maintaining contact.
What's that last
Don't count on your cell phone being the one to maintain contact with your buddy. You know, it takes person-to-person contact. Kathy, you wanted to also cover safety in terms of getting out of devices and stuff, which you need to talk about that, which I have really no experience with, except, you know, once again, if somebody's cutting you out of something.
Yeah, so on Monday morning, we're going to do a workshop on lockdowns, where we'll look at a couple of common ways that people lock themselves to devices to lock themselves either to or to each other in a way that makes it easier for them to hold space, more difficult for law enforcement or security forces to move them and get through. One of the common ways that folks do that is it's called a lockbox or a sleeping dragon or a gun box. There's all sorts of other forms. It's a tube that PVC tube that I put my arm in, your arm in, and we have a chain around our wrists, and we lock to a pin in the middle, and then we're locked together. Like we can't. So don't really want to talk about how all that works and the technical stuff behind that. But another thing that folks will often do is use a regular bicycle U-lock, and U-lock their neck to a piece of equipment, whether it's the drive shaft of a vehicle or
a wheel axle.
A door, like one of those door handles that like come out like this, any one of those things. So we just wanted to make sure to cover some of the safety things we think about in, often the law enforcement response is to wait, kind of look at it funny. But after some period of time, they're likely to start to try to cut you out. So we're going to talk about a few things that when they're trying to cut you out of however you're locked together, pay attention to. If the thing that you are using to lock yourself to somebody else is metal, they're going to use a grinder to cut you out. And there are going to be sparks. So what you want to, now at this point,
and
lock.
And flecks of metal.
Yeah. And at this point, you don't have a whole lot of choice over the matter, because somebody else is the one cutting you out, and any of your friends who are not locked to you are far, far away from you. Often the folks who are doing this are firefighters. They're firefighters or other emergency crew. They're not law enforcement, which means they're more safe to our houses than law enforcement.
They're pretty skilled at doing this.
Yeah.
They cut people out of accidents.
So, exactly. So, if they haven't thought about doing this stuff, some things we want to kind of, make some noise about, we'll ask them to do, and if not, try to make some noise about and see if we can get our support people to make some noise about, is making sure that you have eye protection, ear protection, and that if whatever it is you're made out, you're locked to is made out of metal, that they cover you with a fire retardant blanket. There's going to be sparks, there's going to be, chunks of metal flying. So
the metal itself carries the heat, so it'll carry it right onto your skin. They may be cutting close to your skin, but that next link is going to get hot as well, even the one they're not cutting.
Right. Usually, there are very few devices where the thing that they would cut is actually going to touch your skin.
Right.
I think.
Right.
It
usually doesn't.
If that's the case, then yeah, it can. Sparks will fly. So that's just some stuff that we don't necessarily have control over, because it's somebody else who's cutting you. But it's something that we should certainly be asking for, demanding. And if we have friends who are locked to something and we're seeing them get distracted and they're not taking those very basic safety precautions, then we should be filming it, and we should be making noise and chanting and doing whatever else to make sure that our friends who are in this very precarious position of being locked to something and probably not having a real good time right there know that somebody's at least paying attention to their basic safety in that step. So that's really all I had about getting unlocked.
But what's the best weapon you have while they're doing that and they've not given you any protection, is your voice. Just start screaming. Start screaming, you're hurting me, whatever it takes to get attention so that people know something's going on. And generally, I think you're absolutely right, most of the people who do that are really quite professional. They're pretty good at it. They're generally not terribly mean folks. Not like the cops. They're not as pissed off as some of the rescue personnel. They see it as a test of their own skill, a lot of their muscles. Sometimes they've been able to do it in a while. They love it.
I think this, another thing that's important in that is that most of those lockboxes are designed that at any time you can decide to get yourself out. And I think it's really important to do that, you know, and that, like, you know, to know that this is going to happen, to know that these are the steps that, like, you are putting yourself into the situation and these are the risks that you're taking, and to know what you're prepared to do, but to also not to be in a place where we are locking ourselves up without the key. And those lock boxes have a way that only ourselves can get in them. You're sharing your little explain tomorrow. But you don't necessarily think you could be prepared for that. But then you'd be in that situation and they're grinding, like, you know, you say stop, you get out of yourself out.
You have a history of anxiety or panic attacks, be honest about that and don't participate in the lockdown. Don't tell me you got your Ativan with you. I don't care. It's not going to work. Because after you've been in there for a while, you're going to start feeling like they're fined and panicked and worried. And when they start cutting you out, it's going to be even worse. Just don't do it. For the safety of your friends and comrades, don't do it. Yeah. It's not worth it. You have other things, other roles you can play that are just as important.
Greenpeace, before they let anybody lock down in an action, they do a simulation where they cut. They put you in there and then you sit there. Well, they cut you out, so you know what to expect. We don't have grinders, so we can't lock you out. We can't cut you out. We also don't have time and money.
That's a good idea.
You haven't spoken about how action of the individual direct action participants can cause their own harm by being undisciplined or being loose cannons or threatening police even though they don't think they are. I mean, those kind of issues are also safety issues, aren't they?
Yeah, and I think we have a tendency to get sucked into thinking we always have to defend this person. Because at some point, I mean, if you're working in affinity groups, if you have a buddy system, you may do everything in your power, I think, to persuade that person that this kind of activity is hurting everybody else and needs to stop. And you may stick with them for a little while, but at some point, it may be the group's decision, or maybe folks will disagree with me here, the group's decision to say, you're going to be on your own here. You know, it's we can't risk everybody else because of you. We're not going to jail. And of course, there's also the issue, is that person as a provocateur? Is that person planted, you know? Even though, and in some cases it's not, you know, in many cases it's not. Nonetheless, the person needs to know that they don't have the right to make this individual decision.
Well, it's important to stick with the script.
Stick with the script. Mm-hmm. With the script, unless you quickly make a decision collectively to stick to a different script, but it's still a script. Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right. And our loyalty at some point is to the struggle and not to an individual.
Yes.
That's the important thing.
Yeah.
Loyalty is never to an individual, no matter how close we are to them. It's to the struggle and advancing the struggle and winning these victories. That's what matters.
Yeah, you don't want to be a hero or whatever.
There are no, we shouldn't
martyrs.
Be heroes.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Okay, thank